Okay, and so we continue with the third talk today. I'm very happy Joe Mux is with us. I go to that side, can see him better. Joe is a British journalist, writer, and also a DJ. And he writes really for all the major music outlets that many of us read these days. The Wire, Resident Advisor, Guardian, Mixmag, and also for Bandcamp Daily. And he will soon, this year, publish a book, his first book. It's called Bass Mids and Tops, or Bass Mids Tops, A Social History of England's Sound System Culture. And that's also the foundation for the talk he will give today. The talk is called Subsonic Social History, and subsonic, of course, referring here to the bass culture that is so strong in Britain. And in his book, he's detailing the history of these bass cultures through a series of interviews, and it's a collaboration with a photographer, so it's also a visual portrait of that cultures. And before Joe starts, I want to say Joe also DJs tomorrow on our ice rink in Eishalle in Berghain at starting as of 2 o'clock, I think, from, no, six. He starts at six. Doors open there at two already. And yeah, just to announce that you might have heard that the ice skating didn't really work the way it was supposed to. The surface of that artificial ice didn't really deliver what was told to us it would, and there was a bit of debate around it, and so we decided today to switch it into roller skating. So as of today, at starting, yeah, already now at 4 p.m. people can roller skate, and that will continue all through the next week until Sunday. So I hope you guys come out and we have a bit of a roller disco, or actually Joe says he's gonna play dark ambient
roller drone.
So please welcome Joe. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm flattered you've all come to hear what I've got to say. I hope you're still here by the end, because really what I'm talking about here is an evolving idea constantly. I am in the final stretch of finishing this book. Everything is being handed to the publishers in the next week. There's footnotes upon footnotes upon footnotes to finish off in the next couple of days. And that final rounding off process, making sure all the chapters work together, making sure the introduction all fits around it and so on, is constantly making me reassess why I've even done this in the first place, which is what I'm here to talk about. You know, I can't speak for England and I can't speak for sound system culture, but I can tell you something about how I came to it, what my link is, how it relates to the Englishness that I know. I'll explain why I'm saying Englishness rather than Britishness a little way down the line. And I can hopefully explain something of the methods that have emerged from my process that I feel might potentially be helpful in the documenting of social history. I want to start with a video, though, just a short video that the final chapter that I'm editing at the moment led me to watching this one over and over again. It's a favourite. It's from my teenage years. This is from when I was 15, and so just discovering heavy bass and marijuana and all the other things that go with it. So, yeah, hopefully we'll get some sound as well.
I'm wishing on a star. I'm wishing on a dream.
I'm just going to set my pictures scrolling now. But without sound, perhaps. Beautiful. Okay. So I mean, that video, I swear, it gives me spine tingles every time. It's very special to me. It was something that I loved at the age of 15. It was like I grew up in the countryside, okay, in a town where I think there may have been three non-white families. It was as traditional English as you can get. King Alfred, the medieval king of England, was born in my town. You know, seeing videos like this, straight away it's exciting. It tells you about a world out there. It tells you. My friends were starting to go out raving it by this point, and that was in Bristol, which was in reach of where we lived. So I already knew that, like, my friends or my friends' older brothers or sisters were going to places like this. And what you can see in that video. That's a real place, by the way. It's not like some staged arena for it. Fresh Four. So Fresh Four was DJ Crust, who obviously became part of Ronnie Size Represent and one of the greatest electronic musicians, I think, of any genre himself, Crust. His brother Flynn and a group of other Bristol friends. That record was produced by Smith & Mighty. Now, both DJ Crust and Rob Smith of Smith & Mighty are in my book. You'll see them eventually scrolling through on these pictures. The yard in which the nighttime party part of that video was filmed, I don't know if any of you spotted 3D from Massive Attack also dancing away in the middle of the crowd there, but that yard was a squat in Bristol, which had been squatted for quite some years by the early 80s when DJ Crust was a schoolboy and started bringing his friends to breakdance in their backyard. And that squat was very linked into the British psychedelic industrial new age traveler kind of movement. When I talked to Crust, he talked about the hippies who lived there taking him and his school friends over the Bristol Channel to Wales to these kind of rural hippie communes where they would go and have hip-hop parties. Living also in this squat were Mark Stewart, formerly of the pop group, probably one of the most experimental of the British post-punk bands, who themselves had been produced by Dennis Bavell and Adrian Sherwood, who again are in this book, and Gary Clayle, a teenage Gary Clayle, also lived in this squat, who would go on to live in to work with Adrian Sherwood. So straight away in this record, which is a beautiful, accessible record, so accessible it reached number 10 in the pop charts. You have lines and lines and lines of Englishness, of English subcultural history, all coming together in that one party. And of course, it looks like a good party. It looks like the kind of thing you'd want to go to. And I mean, what you hear in that music, of course, is a certain set of things that could only have come together in Britain in the late 80s. You can see the b-boy style in all of the clothes they're wearing. All of these guys in Fresh Four had come from a breakdance background. Crust talks vividly about seeing Wild Style, the film, when he was 13, 14, and within minutes, him and his friends like calling each other up and going, right, this is what we're going to do, this is our plan, this is how we're going to do it, we're going to have dance burn-offs. And he started making money from that age, you know, so throwing dance burn-offs at first in a room at school, then a youth club, and then at this squat. You can hear the dub, of course. This is reggae sound system music through and through, those huge snares exploding, the bass line, the tempo, the way people are dancing. It's all from people who've had, by this time, a generation's worth of experience of reggae sound systems. And you're just getting you have this soul influence, of course. Soul culture in England especially is undersung when we talk about underground culture, but you know, researching this book and talking to people anyway, the soul weekenders, the not just the northern soul parties, which were kind of high energy, but the southern soul culture, which had kind of partly evolved from mod and partly evolved from other things, fed into the invention of one of the first true British genres, which was lovers rock. The first British reggae genre was lovers rock, which was, you know, it was sweet soul music. It was based on aspirational, slick, high production value American soul with obviously the Jamaican undercurrent, and Dennis Bavell was probably the great pioneer of that. So yes, you can see all of those things come together in that video, and it looks, to my eyes anyway, strikingly fresh still. It's partly that those styles and certain of the sounds have never gone away. The funky drum has never gone away. The sound of a dub bass line's never gone away. But b-boy style as well remains with us today. And it's easy to think often that that's because things... Look, you can see Samurai, one of the younger interviewees on my book there, with his Adidas tracksuit, which would have fitted perfectly well in that video. All of these things remain with us, and there's a great temptation to think, oh, culture has run its cycle, it's come to a dead end, there's nothing new under the sun. But at the same time, when you realize how fresh it looked then, and then you see, if you see an equivalent group of people throw a party in a piece of disused land now, it still looks good. It looks good because it looks good. It's some certain things survive, and you know, studying these the way these things repeat has often made me start trying to, well, drifting into thinking in evolutionary terms. It's like when something occupies a niche successfully, does it need to evolve? Anyway, that's what was in that video. This is kind of all the stuff that is currently swimming around my head as I tie up the loose ends of this book, and these are kind of some of the loose ends I've tied up. How I got here was, well, I'm not going to give you the full life story that led me through to dubstep, because that would take the whole of this story, the years from 1989 when I was 15 and starting to get excited by going out. I think suffice to say, bass was always present for me. The next thing after that was hearing LFO and Nightmares on Wax and the Yorkshire bleep and bass, the stuff that seeded bass into rave music. And ever since then, the things that I've had Catholic tastes, but the things that have really kept gravitating back to, like a gravitational pull, is the sub bass, the sound of the 808 kick or the dub bass line and so on. So when dubstep came around in the early 2000s, I felt an affinity, and it became something that I got attached to, and kind of, I hadn't been professionally writing for long. I'd spent most of the 90s doing what you do in the 90s. But I kind of was beginning to be a professional writer by the time dubstep broke through, and I kind of, you know, my career moved forward as dubstep expanded, and its expansion, of course, was after its initial kind of few years gestation period, its expansion was explosive. So it was I was able to trace these same British influences, the same things, the influence of US hip hop culture, US dance culture, soul, the psychedelic industrial kind of white British alternative culture, dub, of course. All of these things were folded back into dubstep, and it was around that time that I really started to. I'd never thought about any of this stuff consciously, really, and through my years of raving and involvement with music up until this point. And I started. This is the cover for the book, by the way. Hence, this is where we got the title from. Brian, the photographer with whom I've done this, is a former roadie, so he's obsessed with the patina of speakers, because he spent half his life with his face up against them. So when I started getting to interview a lot of the names within dubstep, and you know, it was an exciting time, especially as you came to the end of the 2000s, and it was going international, and at a time when a lot of other music seemed like, I mean, you know, this may seem mealy-mouthed coming from a middle-class white guy, but seemed very middle-class and very white, a lot of the bands, a lot of the things that were happening. Suddenly there was this working-class music from a very specific locality, just like Bristol had had its thing previously. Croydon, this kind of unprepossessing area, had these characters. You had Scream and Benger and Walsh and Hatcher and Plastician and Chef and Crazy D, and every one of them a character, a kind of rock star in the making. And it felt like these were much better rock stars than any of the rock stars around. And I started wondering how this had all come about, tracing it back through the things that I'd experienced through Garage and Jungle, and it was two conversations that I had around that time. I remember speaking to Scream in, there's DJ Crust. I remember speaking to Scream in about 2008 or 9, and I was like, you know, people always don't want to be labelled. Musicians always don't pigeonhole me. And I was like, he was like, oh, I don't know, I call it dubstep. And I was like, well, what do you call it? He was like, it's mongrel music. And which kind of summed up what I'd been feeling. This was an expression of radical English hybridity, the kind of hybridity that has made that is the other side of our country from the colonial nation. This is the country that absorbs what comes into it, that has absorbed the Indian and Caribbean and Gypsy and Huguenot and Jewish and every wave of immigration that's come in, and especially in the cities, especially in the industrial areas, has created strong and living cultures out of that. And this word mongrel music, this kind of very quite crass, cheeky term, just really stuck with me. And around this time, I had been very frustrated with music writing up until this point. I mean, you know, I loved it. I grew up on the NME, I grew up on the Mixmag, I grew up on the Face, I grew up on all these great titles, reading a lot of great writers, and reading people, their Scream, reading, you know, not just the sort of names that we know as writers, but people like Andrew Weatherall and Marianne Hobbs were writing in a lot of the titles I read growing up. But I grew endlessly frustrated with the obsession with the moment, the punk moment, the Woodstock moment, the acid house moment, and I always felt that this was a kind of a reductionist way of doing things. I remember reading some Rolling Stone talking about how rock and roll was a fusion of African music via black slaves and Celtic music via the hillbillies. And that was it. It was like these kind of like these Pat stories. And, you know, the more I had lived experience of underground culture, of sound system culture, of rave culture, all of these things, I was like, well, that's not how things happen at all. And around this time, again, you know, the late 2000s, I started being aware of Simon Reynolds's theories of senius, the word senius, which is great, this kind of concept of something that's emergent, of brilliant ideas that are emergent, not just from one individual genius or one idea, but like from a complex group of people. And the other one of the hardcore continuum, which was great because it expanded kind of beyond this idea of the moment, of the jungle moment, or the garage moment or whatever, into, yeah, it's a continuum, okay, I can see that. And it served as a really good descriptive principle of especially London pirate stroke rave stroke sound system music of a certain time period, from hardcore rave up until dubstep and grime. And then I started getting frustrated with that as well, and because it had become kind of proprietary. It kind of seemed like, well, no, this is where we draw the line around this music, and it's bigger than the so-called acid house moment or whatever that you know journalists would hang on to, but it's still an arbitrary delineation around a set of music, and you know, within the letters page of The Wire and various blog column posts, there was some fairly spicy debate that went on around this. But it was transformational to the way I thought about things, because my instant reaction, as soon as I kind of felt some dissatisfaction with that, was to think of multiple continua. I thought of, okay, well, we have the hardcore continua, but yes, we also have this soul continuum and the b-boy continuum, the electro and breakdance influence that goes through these things. You have the psychedelic industrial continuum. And when you start seeing them weaving together, then this, you can start unpicking or reweaving or being selective about how you put them together. And then narratives start to emerge, specific narratives. So the second conversation, apart from Scream, that I had around this same time was with a DJ and producer, very, very talented. He has a day job, so he rarely actually does stuff, but Grievous Angel, some of you may have come across him, Paul Meme from Sheffield. He did a rework of a Dusk and Blackdown album. He's done some amazing online mixes. He's a super talent. But he's older than me, and he was doing amazing stuff with grime and dubstep, and I was like, you've got such an affinity for this. And he was like, Well, I saw The Clash in 1981 with Futura 2000 on stage behind them, painting the New York graffiti artist who obviously would later go on to do all the artwork with James Lavelle and Mo Wax. And I was like, oh yeah. Obviously, The Clash were working with Lee Scratch Perry. The Clash were using dub technique all over the place. They were covering reggae songs. They became, especially Mick Jones, became fascinated with the emergent US hip-hop culture. And there it was. There was the same set of influences, versions of the same set of influences that were folding into each other again and again at different points, and we're coming back together in dubstep. So that really, about 10 years ago, was the seed of this book. It was the idea of tracing those interweaving influences and the different ways that they had come together through time. Didn't have the idea of doing it as a book, but it became a kind of guiding principle at that point. I started a website shortly afterwards, and that I didn't quite have this clarity on the focus on bass culture particularly, but I started working with Brian, the photographer, and we started just doing a few interviews with people who had crossed over between certain different areas of music, people who had long careers and had sort of woven through a few different things. So Zed Bias was in there, Tony Thorpe of Moody Boys, Marianne Hobbs, I think we had on there. There were a couple, but I wasn't being paid, and transcribing 10,000 word interviews is hard, and it petered out. But the verbatim long interview it stuck with me, and I started doing more and more of these for Fact and places like this. I interviewed quite a few people who actually could easily have been in this book. Hatcher and Noodles, there's Tony Thorpe. A number of British bass musicians, and it really worked. Even more obscure people I was able to put into Fact magazine and with a bit of arm twisting, persuade them that, yeah, I should do 10,000 word interviews actually, and just leave everything in, leave all the detail in. And over the next few years, it became clear that it was the tiny details that led to the emergent picture of how all of the strands were weaving together. And really, that's what's brought me here. We had a couple of misfires. As soon as I said this to Brian, it was like, let's do a book of long interviews with pictures. We had a couple of misfires with finding publishers. We thought, oh, should we do it as an exhibition and just put the interviews online, or should we restart the website? And eventually, it fell together with Strange Attractor, the publisher. And as soon as we had a publisher, I wish the timing had been better because Dennis Bevel just popped up. The person who would begin it all just came into my head that it would be Dennis Bevel. That he's not Jamaican actually, he's from Barbados. But when he came over to the UK in the 60s, he played with mod bands, he played with rock bands, he became a mega producer, but it was somehow 1979 became our kind of magic point. 1979 was the kind of year zero of post-punk. This is when Public Image Limited started bringing in the heavy bass lines with Jar Wobble. It's when The Clash started doing all their kind of New York influence stuff. And it's when Dennis Bevel produced The Slits and the pop group, bringing all of this technique from Caribbean sound system culture. It's also the year that he released Silly Games, the track that he wrote and produced for Janet Kay, this kind of perfect British lovers rock song. So you had these two strands of the soulful, aspirational, smooth, absolutely artistry-filled British, very British music, and the ragged, raw, bass heavy, but these are both bass heavy strands, experimentalist, psychedelic, stoned, whatever side with the pop group and the Clash and the Slits and all these people. And Dennis was there right in the heart of it. So as soon as I managed to get him and I sat him down and I got an hour and a half of anecdote out of him, and this is someone who's had his hand in so many records. I mean, he produced right in Lagos for Richie Sakamoto. I mean, you know, this is a god amongst modern musicians. And then it just kind of fell together. Norman Jay, again, you know, this is a man who turned British reggae sound system culture into soulful, eclectic sound system culture and was able to stick with it all the way through Jungle and Garage and somehow maintain this kind of... Norman Jay was a mod, which is a very British thing to be. You know, he was a black mod from West London. And then each time, Zed Bias, Mala, Toddler T, each of these people fell into place. And, you know, there was a few that I would have wanted or that could easily have been in. But it became emergent. And suddenly I found what feels like, and I really hope that this is the case, a way where... my position as coming from this small market town where my first experience of hearing reggae properly loud was that my dad used to work in a job centre in Reading and he played cricket with his colleagues in a Sunday team called the Aging Hippie All-Stars. And, you know, Reading being quite a multicultural town, they would play against Indian and Caribbean teams, and yet there was a couple of teams of Rastas who they discovered shared influences with, and he would invite his cricketing mates around my house and sit on the lawn and turn the stereo up. And that was literally, you know, my dad, an old hippie, had quite a nice sound system, so this was my sound system culture. This is how it kind of, the threads reach through England, a small country, really. But nonetheless, you know, I couldn't claim to have been an inner city practitioner of this music by any means. But through this kind of emergent pattern of letting conversations lead the way, letting intersecting conversations, because a lot of these people know each other, a lot of these people have had shared interests. You know, Sarah Lockhart, who runs Rinse FM, kind of sits right at the heart of it. I think the kind of middle part of the book is her and Terra Danger, the grime producer, who as a teenager had come all the way through the jungle scene and watched the very birth of grime, and Sarah had come through the hardcore and jungle scene and kind of, you know, watched Rinse turn from a jungle station into the international force that it is now. Watching the patterns emerge became my way of going, okay, I'm not in control of this. I'm not claiming ownership over this. I'll take credit for the hard work it took to actually get some of these people to sort themselves out. It took literally 2 months of texting Sarah Lockhart every single day after she'd agreed to do it, to fix a time for her to come and do it. A lot of these are very busy and or... heavy smokers, so the organisational aspects of this book I will take full credit for. But yeah, I feel like I can't even conceptualise it yet because I have no distance from the process. But as I finish it off and as I go through the process of annotating the chapters and researching who are these people that each of the people talk about, what are the micro details that are going on here, what was that club, when did it open and close, where did that MC then go on to join which crew, my job is as I'm going to say a fucking silly word, an amanuensis for the interviewees. I'm here to channel their stories. And so the English, and I'm saying English because it ended up being that there were no Scottish or Welsh interviewees. That's purely how it happened, actually. Nicolette was born in Scotland, but and had some time in Cardiff, but really doesn't count as Scottish, I don't think. But this is this is what bass culture is. Bass culture is Terra Danger telling about his putting a pen into the label at the back of his Gap baseball cap at jungle raves so that he could have a pen to get girls' numbers, because it was in the days before you could just put your numbers in your phone, and he didn't want to put his pen into his Moschino jeans. It's like, this is jungle. This fine detail is what jungle is. It's, you know, it's Crust talking about how he used the phono to cassette select button as the transformer to do his first scratching on his mum's gramophone. It's Rob Smith there. He had a 12-seater Citroen, which he would take Crust and Flynn and anyone else from Bristol who turned up at his house at the right time on a Friday night out to the free parties, to the Traveller Sound System parties, at which Southwestern Jungle was kind of precipitated, where it was where Crust first met Ronnie Size. And the image of this 12-seater Citroen car rolling through the streets of Bristol with these people talking, thick Bristol burrs, all of this is the sound, this is the story. It's as much the story as the tales of dub plates or who was the promoter at which rave or whatever, which is also in there. But I hope it works. I hope when it finds, it's going to be a big book, 25 chapters. Some of them, the Terra Danger interview was 3 hours long, and I've kept it verbatim. I've kept the whole thing because I feel this detail is important. His chapter has some 130 footnotes that I have had to go through, and these are details which are not Googleable. So it's calling people up and going, who is this person that he's mentioned? Anyway, I hope it works. I hope that it provides a model for presenting the long strands of cultural history. I was going to fling in a metaphor to kind of make the title fit, and it kind of works, that Steve Goodman, Code 9, wrote in Sonic Warfare a lot about how bass produces force fields that have a completely their own geography, topography within an urban or rural environment that's different to the topography of the buildings, because bass goes through walls. And I love this idea of bass penetrating through things and soaking through things. You know, it's how you find the party. You might be walking looking for a basement rave and you hear it before you see it. You hear it before you see the people going in. You feel it through the soles of your feet. And I guess if there's a kind of metaphor for what I've ended up doing here, it's that idea of this kind of throb of the sound system going beneath and through the categories that I got frustrated with as a journalist, and creating shapes that I could discern by looking through all these stories and somehow document. So that's where I am right now. Might change in a couple of days, but there we go. Are there any questions? I'm absolutely fine if there are no questions. I have quite a dry throat. Oh, yeah, okay, in the middle.
To read the book, by the way, it sounds fascinating. You mentioned about how difficult it was to get these interviews. Were there any people that you wanted to speak to that you weren't able to? Who were like the ones that got away, maybe?
Yes. So there was a few. It would, now that I'm reaching the final stage, I kind of feel like, fuck 'em. It would have been a different book had Daddy G said yes at one point from Massive Attack Grant, and then he's quite reticent as a person, and he was like yes, and then disappeared off on holiday, and it was like, oh, I don't really trust this. And you know, obviously having Massive Attack's name in there probably would have sold a few more copies. I feel like having got Rob Smith instead to tell that era of Bristol story, it's more of an untold story. I think his story is a particularly great one and connects dots that it would have been nice to have him. James Blake said yes, and I think he would have been an interesting inclusion. Mala talks very fondly of him. Digo from Four Hero talks very fondly of James Blake, which I was interested to hear. And I think James is a often misunderstood figure, and to put him in this context would have been good, but it didn't happen. The one, and I think he would have skewed it as well. He would have skewed the latter part of the book towards a different, more internationalist, because of, you know, what he does now. So Mala kind of tells his story in his chapter. The one that I do regret not saying yes is Naina Cherry. I think she would have formed an amazing kind of linchpin within it. At the back.
Hi, Joe.
Hello.
I'm really interested to get into the visual and oral history you've compiled. I was wondering what you think, if you think this sort of generation of dubstep and subsonic music has ended somewhat. I mean, the closure of Plastic People, the deaths of Space Ape and Mark Fisher. Like, what are you excited about in the future for this sort of music?
This is a fascinating time. It again and again in the later parts of the book, the later interviewees, it seems like there hasn't been a single strand to sound system music since 2011, really. By 2011, dubstep had kind of, it was having its moment of being fully global and had kind of detached itself. And dubstep is still alive and interesting and is still happening and is still has its heart in Croydon and its heart in Bristol. And there's a very, very kind of rootsy dubstep thing that has, I think part of the whole point of this book is to see these things as part of ongoing flows and you know, this very rootsy dubstep connections between people like Mala and Congo Natty and Dub Chasm and Jar Shaka. You get this brilliant, brilliant bass continuum, and that is alive and well. I think what's really become vivid to me over the three or so years I've been doing this is how amazingly alive the jazz continuum is in Britain, and how that has always been a part of the sound system continuum. Every time, every generation, there's a wave of soul and jazz that kind of sweeps in and revives the bass music. Giles Peterson keeps getting mentioned again and again and again by different characters in this book, because obviously he's supported Mala, he signed Ronnie Size Represent, he signed Nicolette, and the broken beat scene, I think, is kind of represented here by Digo, but the broken beat scene is very, very untold story in UK bass history. It's underappreciated in its importance because it was a very tight knit, and sometimes sort of some of the people involved were quite prickly, and it was, you know, it had a certain degree of musical snobbishness around it or something. But that is creating absolutely extraordinary fusions at the moment. I mean, this is before I get to the kind of what you might call the majority black scenes of the British cities at the moment, the drill scene, which is producing new hybrids already. There's like drill producers who had been listening to their older brothers and sisters' garage records, and you're starting to hear garage licks in drill records. And obviously the whole Afrobeats into bashment into R&B scene is unbelievably fertile, and that has constantly fed back and back and back into, I guess what you might call more underground or hybrid scenes. So what the swing ting guys, you see Samurai coming around, the tall skinny Asian guy, they do up in Manchester. I think the various cities of Britain are particularly exciting at the moment. Bristol is absolutely electric, and Manchester especially. I mean, God, Sheffield, Nottingham, Leeds, all absolutely having it with really interesting kind of community projects and their own little hybrids. But Manchester really is exciting for me because of what the swing ting guys are doing with West African. They're actually bringing, you know, West African producers over to collaborate. They're fusing with dancehall. They use kind of dancehall as their base level of their parties, but they're creating really interesting things. And the Levels guys, this kind of sprawling, they call themselves Happy Mondays meets Wu-Tang Clan, but you know, they're plugged into the drum and bass scene. Drum and bass is really fertile. Drum and bass is seems to be doing more creative stuff than ever, and is the seat for MC culture outside of the bigger cities in more kind of what you might call provincial areas. I mean, drum and bass MC culture is really fascinating, and that had its huge kind of peak. I don't know if it's had its peak yet, but SASASAS. I can't remember how many SAs there are in there, but they're taking the drum and bass scene, bringing UK hip hop, bringing grime artists. I mean, RIP Stormin, but the having this kind of drilled multi-genre MC team with an amazing fast-cutting young old DJ duo is kind of straight away that you can see fascinating fusions where that's happening, where previously it's been the kind of spacey end of drum and bass, the kind of what they call the autonomic or half-time thing. Now the harder end of drum and bass is kind of stepping up with more experimental things. So there doesn't seem to be one answer. It's hard to see how we could have another dubstep at this stage or another jungle at this stage. But every time someone says that, that's when it happens. I remember just when I'd started writing professionally, I got my first two kind of big jobs were for the Daily Telegraph and the Face magazine, just in the final days of the Face, and was constantly being told there's no such thing as underground anymore. This is when the internet was like everywhere, and they were like, the internet means that everyone can have everything all the time. I was like, no. And sure enough, that was 2002 or so, and that was exactly when dubstep, grime, and other kind of small underground things managed to turn into world-changing things. So one of these little hybrids could well turn into something global. Who knows? I hope that helps. Anyone else? Good, because I think I'm about to lose my voice, actually. All right. Well, awesome. Thank you so much. And they'll give me a publication date when I actually hand the final bits in, but it looks probably like early June, so keep your eye out, and I'll probably be on the promo circuit, so I'll be back.